Come on, let's give God praise in this place. Let's give God praise in this place. Oh God, we love you on this morning, oh God. We reverence you, oh God. We glorify you, oh God. But there is nobody like the God that we serve. Because there's no greater love than the God that we serve. And God, we thank you, oh God, for showing your love, for showing your grace, and showing your mercy. And God, we thank you. The song simply says, I really love you. Does anybody have the love of the Lord on this morning? Just say,
I really love you. I really love you, Jesus, because you first love me. I really love you. Yes, I do. Yeah.
I really love you
with all of your heart, Jesus.
I really love you.
Hey. With all your soul.
Because you first love me.
Today,
oh my God, somebody make some noise in here if you really, really love them. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Well, this is the day that the Lord has made. And if you really love him, he just simply says, hey, come on, what you gonna do? Rejoice and be glad in it. That means to rejoice means you've made up your mind because you have encountered how good God is and that no person, no situation could ever, never, ever steal what God has for you. So nothing could ever take your praise. Nothing can never move you out of your position with God. Can I teach for a moment? I mean, that when you make that decision, it doesn't matter what happens in the world system. It won't move me from where God had me. So can anybody in here make some noise this Hallelujah. Morning? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I don't know about you, but I came to see Jesus today. I came to see Jesus, and I came to get what is mine in the name of the Lord. Amen. Well, welcome to all of you near and far, those who are here in the sanctuary today, and glad to see y'all today. Amen. And those who are watching today via all of the social medias, amen. If you're enjoying us, just hit those like buttons. But more importantly, we want you to come on and join us right here in the sanctuary. So you still got time. Leave your house right where you are. Come to the worship service right now and come in person and worship with us. You're not going to miss some things that we're doing. We're getting ourselves geared up. And if not, if you got some demarcation in time, hey, let Easter be a demarcation time where you can come on back and come on into the sanctuary, because we're here and we're praising the Lord. So we just want to welcome you again here at the great historic Calvary Baptist Church, where we do nothing else but worship the Lord Jesus Christ. Will you join with me in our Lord's Prayer right now? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not in temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Come on, man, I guarantee you, if you just give God some praise, he'll come down right where you are. Come on, he deserves it, and you ought to open up your mouth and give God some praise, the one who's giving you the victory.
Anywhere,
hallelujah.
Anytime. Every day is a good day to praise God, amen? It's not until I stop complaining about the problems that I have and start blessing God for the problems that I don't have. Hello? Can somebody hear me?
Yes.
Good morning, my brothers and sisters. We've been blessed to see yet another day above ground. Although this is Sunday, we've seen many Sundays, but we've never seen this Sunday. So why don't we give God some praise
Hallelujah.
On this?
Hallelujah. Yes.
Whether we're home, whether we're here, why don't we just take our time and just be thankful, give God praise, and let us recite the increased confession. Amen. Amen. It is so good to see everybody in the sanctuary. Makes you want to lift your hands up.
That's right.
I think there's an old school song, want to just
Thank
holler
you,
and throw up both your hands. Come
Wonderful
on now.
God.
Let's go ways back. Glory, glory, yes, glory to his name. Amen. Let us recite the increased confession. Heavenly Father, I thank you for my many blessings. And I thank you as I give my tithes and offering. I'm believing the Lord for wisdom to make the right choices, revelational knowledge to know you better, spiritual eyes to see the hurt in others, love to embrace those who come against me, spiritual insight to understand the word of truth, health so that every body part performs to the perfection for which it was created. For the peace of God to remain settled in the midst of the battles. For the mind of Christ to administrate your authorities properly. Jobs and better jobs. Businesses and better businesses. Raises and bonuses. Benefits, sales and commissions. Settlements, estates and inheritance. Interest and incomes, rebates and returns, discounts and dividends, checks in the mail, gifts and surprises, finding money, scholarships and tuitions, Bills decrease and bills paid off.
Yes, Lord.
Blessings and increase. Thank you, Lord, for meeting my financial needs so that I have more than enough to give into the kingdom of God and to promote the gospel of Jesus Christ. God bless you. Amen.
Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Checks in the mail. Bills paid off. Glory to God. Who's the only one that can do that for you? Jesus. And we know that Jesus will. You ask, he will. Holly, you commission him to do something, he will. You pray about it long enough, he will. Glory to God. Come on, put your hands together, Calvary. You can stand on your feet. You can get in the aisle. Hallelujah. Those out there that are praising the Lord today, just understand that God will. Oh, 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 oh. Ooh, opens doors that I cannot see. Jesus will, fail. Jesus will. And who will make all my decisions?
Because
he said he would.
He said he will.
He'll fight my battle.
He'll fight.
said he would.
Yeah.
Somebody shout, Jesus will. Look at somebody else and say, Jesus already did it. Come on, if that's you, if he's already done it, come on, make some noise in here. Let me just see who I'm talking to. If he said he would heal your body, come on, stand up if that's you. If he said he would bless you as a parent, if that's you, come on. If he said you're going to come out of your situation and it didn't look like the devil said you wasn't going to come out, if that's you, stand up. It isn't that Jesus will. He's done it already. Come on, make some noise in here for the God who keeps his promises. For the God who keeps his promises. We thank God for the praise team. Amen. They set the course already. The mere fact that we know Jesus will. Fight my battle. I don't have to go through it. I keep telling people all the time. They keep coming to me with stuff. And sometimes I tell my wife, I said, what's the worry? Why you got to do it? Jesus is going to fight this thing for us. If all we have to do is stay in his attributes. I can't get nobody. All we have to do is stay in his attributes. All we got to do is stay in his place of love, stay in his place of mercy, stay in his place of forgiveness. You ain't got to go and... And God will work it out. God will work it out. I don't think some of the biblical leaders was that they didn't have a course in leadership. They just had trust in God, and God took them through each and everything. Amen, somebody? Amen, amen. Well, I'm glad to see each and every one of you this morning. Glad to be in the house. Anybody glad to be in the house one more time? Yeah. I don't know, but I don't really know. I think that line in that scripture, that song, Selena said, they didn't have to let me in. What does that mean? Amen. Would somebody guard the door, didn't let people in? Is that the line? They didn't have to let me in? Do they say that? I'm like, what in the heck does that mean? Is there somebody that won't let people in or something like that? You know, but I'm glad to be in the service one more time. I like to say they didn't have to roll me in. Come on, say amen. That's the line I put in there. And I don't mean in a wheelchair. Amen. I mean, on that long thing, they didn't roll me in. I came in on my own because I came here for one reason and one reason only. Now, some of us have different functions this morning because there's somebody that's worked the camera, and Minister Clayhorn has to lead the music, and the praise team has to sing. Everybody's got different functions. The ushers are ushering. And those are some functions, but we all came here for the same reason, and that's to give thanks and to worship our God, who is mighty and who has never, I just heard him say, who never lost a battle, and know that Jesus will. Amen? Amen. Amen. Well, let me just, I want to finish something I was working with you last week, and I was calling it faithfulness, the key to created purpose. And I want to stay there because I'm still talking about how to operate and how to function according to purpose. And I want to talk with you a little bit. I'm going to pray, and then we're going to be right off to the races. I don't know about y'all, but I am really feeling, I don't know if I should say this, but I'm really feeling this 10 o'clock time. I don't know about y'all. Anybody else? Am I by myself? Don't leave me by myself. Amen. Praise the Lord. It's almost like doing last year, right, during COVID. You were sitting at home in your pajamas watching Calvary. Amen. Wasn't that cool? You was eating Fruit Loops and Cheerios and stuff, you know. And many of you did like we did. I mean, I've talked to many. I've talked to the Clayhorns. I've talked to other. Many of you doing it with, it became, in our home, it became a family affair. We all got ourselves ready, gathered around the TV set, and began to watch the service. Amen. Watch the service. And it was good. And then for a long time, many of y'all thought, well, y'all thought we was here Sunday morning all the whole time. Y'all didn't know. But it was all good. We had a great time in the Lord. I don't know if I don't know if anybody can help me. I don't know if they were able to do the. Is this saved from last week? Does anybody? They can't do it. They won't be able to do it. All right, not a problem. Not a problem. You know me. I'm going to be able to adjust and modify. So what we're going to do? What we're going to do? I'm going to talk to you, and I'm going to do a quick review from last week. Quick review from last week, and share some things with you. Share some things with you. I believe that God, I'm going to pray in a second, just let me get this out. I believe that God has made all of us and has made us with his thought, his mind, and his creative purpose. He did not design us for us to just be willy-nilly tossed around to and fro based on what we've been through. But God had a unique and purposeful design for you. And in that unique, purposeful design he made for you, he had a mind for you, and he had a set of values for you and morals for you and a set of spiritual kingdom principles for you. Now, the world has another set of principles. They're not always good, but they can be impactful. And if you lend to those, they can scar you, they can wound you, and they can bruise you forever. And you could be the pastor of a church and still be bruised, scarred, and marred by the world system. Somebody once said, hurting people hurt people. So you could be a superintendent, you could be a pastor, you could be a doctor, you could be, and you could just, you ever know those people who just go around, they just say hurtful things and mean? You go like, well, man, you're in the profession of helping people. Why are you so mean? Because you can get credentials. You can get credentials for anything. You can get skill set for anything. But you have to be willing to cooperate to have a mindset of God. This is why God said, let this mind be in you that is also in Christ Jesus. It's not always about positions and titles. Jesus makes that clear all the time. He uses language like, unless you become a servant, you cannot enter. And then use language like this, unless you become like the little children, you cannot enter in. Unless you wash the feet of the others, you cannot be my disciple. He uses words like this, but the world system uses titles and prominence to try to bring affirmation. But Jesus always uses the lowly things. God uses the lowly things to bring prominence to who he is in his kingdom. I want to tell you just off today that faithfulness is the key to creative purpose. And I'm going to walk you through some scripture. I'm going to quickly go through last week, and then we're going to get to the other pieces that I had, and then we'll be finished in terms of what God will do for us today. Amen. Father, we just give your name the praise, honor, and glory. We magnify you and exalt you today, for there is no other God besides you. You are awesome and powerful, and you can do any and everything but fail. You can do any and everything but fail if we put our trust in you and lean not to our own understanding and all of our sources and resources. And realize, oh God, that you are everything and everything I need to survive. So I give you all the praise, honor, and glory this morning. For you are God and God alone. I feel the power of the Holy Ghost in here. You are everything I need. And we give you all the praise in the wonderful, matchless name of Jesus the Christ, we pray. Amen. Come on, somebody say amen in here. Amen. Oh, God. When we begin to talk about faithfulness, and this is just review, when we begin to talk about faithfulness, and faithfulness is the key in which what God wants us to operate in. Faithfulness is important. Faithfulness is what honors God. God is not impressed with, let me just pick on me, you might not be either, but God is not impressed with my teaching or preaching ability, no matter how much I perfect it and how much you are in awe of it and I get accolades from people, he's not impressed with that. He's not impressed with how well you make money for your corporation and how well you do. He's not impressed as much as I am with Michael Jordan and LeBron James. He's not impressed. We are as a world of entertainment and things that satisfy us, but those things don't really move God. What moves God is our faithfulness towards him. A faithfulness towards the things that he has said. I wish I had some parents in the room today who would help me out, that there's a lot of things that your children have done and accomplished, but the things that you've asked them to do is the things that you kind of score them by. There's some things that you've asked them to do. You're looking for them to be faithful in the responsibilities, in the chores, in the attitude, in the way in which you have reared them. You're looking for them to be able to model what you told them to do. And anytime they are not faithful to the things that you have asked them to do, doesn't matter some of the things where they just wanted to go down their own road and not able to listen to the things that you put forth. God is looking for you and I to operate in faithfulness. And there's a lot of noise out here. There's a lot of things that can distract you and I. And even the church can be a distraction. There's a lot of things that can distract you from what God has really called you to. And while you and I are busy looking at other people who are being distracted, they then distract us from the thing that God has called you to be faithful to. Faithfulness is important in the life of the believer. In fact, faithfulness to God is an expression of lordship, small l, lordship. When we understand faithfulness to God, it's an expression of lordship, meaning that he is my Lord. It means that I'm faithful to my Lord and what he's asked me to do. Hey, listen, let me just help you out in here. Sometimes, you know, things happen in Christendom, things happen in church, things happen on your job. But are you faithful to the things that God has asked you to be? Now, listen, people will call you names for your ability or your responsibility and your love for being faithful to God. I'm going to try it again. People will attack you even for your behavior acting like God instead of acting like the world. They will say, aren't you going to do something about that? Aren't you going to score late? And you saying, no, I'm going to be faithful and let God. Can I do the song we just sang? I'm going to be still and let God fight my battle. But then people will look at you like you're a punk. People look at you like you're not handling things. So either you're going to follow all of God, or you're going to come and let you do what you think you need to do. Faithfulness to God is an expression of lordship. I wish somebody would write that down. Because now you don't have to write it down if he isn't your Lord. But if you say he is your Lord, and you say he is your landlord, if you say you're living under his auspices, under his residency, then you got to abide by the rules of the landlord. In my mind, I thought that would be a place where people would clap or get excited. But I know y'all deep thinkers and stuff. I know the people watching. I know y'all got it. Amen. So last week I gave you some definitions of faithfulness. And it's great to write these down because maybe you will explore and maybe something will trigger for you in terms of you understanding our faithfulness is not to the world system. Our faithfulness is to our Lord and Savior. And so faithfulness, definitions, let me just give you some standard Webster dictionary definition of faithfulness. Faithfulness is being diligent, dependable, committed to a purpose. Now remember, I tell you, we are called by God to function according to purpose. So when I talk about these things, I'm talking about being faithfulness, right? The definition of faithfulness is loyal, diligent, dependable, committed to a purpose. I'm just using Webster right now, but clearly, now I want to transition a little bit to God. God is looking for you and I to be diligent with him. Listen, that word diligent is a great word. It's a word that we don't use in this lifetime that we're living in, because that word diligent, Joel's 15, he don't know anything about diligent. And it ain't his fault, because we live in an instant world now. We live in an instant world. Remember, maybe let me date myself for a minute. So sometime mom would take her a minute to make a full meal for us when I was little. You know, it put some effort. Could take half the day, could take a few hours. If she was making up something quick for dinner for us, she'd come home and she'd make up dinner when she hadn't prepared it for us, and it takes a minute. But in my lifetime, when I was a little boy, they came out with this thing called TV dinners. And so TV dinners, you could place them in the oven, and what would normally take mom an hour and a half, 3 hours, whatever, to make meals for our family, she could slide one of these TV dinners in that took about 30 to 45 minutes, depending on what kind of oven you had. Come on, say amen, somebody. You remember the oven? You had to take the match and put the light, pilot light under there. Man, that's some pretty bold stuff to take your face and take a piece of paper, light it on and put your face in front of the pilot light. I tell you, we were absolutely crazy. Amen. So we had a TV dinner, and TV dinners came on the scene and did what they needed to do and whatnot. And even in that, at some point in time, you know, we were a little impatient with something that could come that quick. And then, you know, microwaves came out that would take the same kind of dinner. Now you can get it in about 6 minutes. And you remember with that, even now, microwaves are even faster and more powerful, that when you put something in the microwave for 60 seconds, you'd be like this. Man. Don't get me started talking about internet. Remember when internet first came out? Like you could, like, to make a connection, you could go downstairs, make a sandwich, get a drink, come back upstairs, and you still wasn't connected. But you would wait with excitement and great anticipation, waiting just to hear, you got mail. And now if your internet is just like 3 seconds slow, you are just so impatient. This world doesn't know anything about diligence. Even this walk in Christianity, if I'm going to be faithful, let me just say, I think I'm at a place in my life right now, and it ain't because I'm older, it's because I've been on a constant pursuit of Jesus. And that's why I've been asking folk, who want to be with me? Who wants to be? Because I'm convinced that every church don't put people on a track to be on a constant pursuit of Jesus. I'm convinced that somehow other things become more popular and other things become more permanent in the church than following and being a follower or a disciple of Jesus. But let me tell you this, for those of you who are on pursuit of Jesus, it's going to take diligence. We got our wordsmith here. Queen is in the audience today. So diligence is, it means that something that takes place over a long period of time. You don't just start being good at something. In fact, let me steal some words from Minister Edward. He keeps trying to tell me, he's trying to help his pastor out about going live. And he said, Pastor, come on, you don't want to suck. You got to suck before we're going to be good. And I be going, I don't want to suck. You know why? Because I don't have diligence in that area. I want to just get it. Because we live in a society where nobody wants to have diligence. Diligence is a word that's not even used any longer. It takes time to develop this place where faithfulness to God becomes an expression of lordship. Faithfulness to God, where I'm diligent about learning more and more about his attributes and then making them my own. More and more that what he says and how he describes me as a husband, even if Lady K, come on, y'all, say Lady K, cooperate with Pastor. Y'all are scared to say that. So even if Lady K is not, I'm still, it doesn't matter what she does, I'm still called to be the husband that God describes in the Bible. That takes diligence. Or I could just say the heck with it and do as the world system does. And likewise, so can she. When I'm off, she has to practice being what a wife is. But guess what? It takes time. It takes time. You don't get it in the beginning. You don't get this thing. You don't get faithfulness according to God where it becomes an expression of lordship. It becomes time that I put in. I used to say this over at long ago at the other church where we used to work on. I used to teach on how to be in diligence and how to walk in and moving in. And I had a definition that I coined for diligence. And I said, I coined, anybody remember? I said, diligence is doing a small thing for a long time until you get a big result. Are you with me? Diligence is doing a small thing for a long time until you get a big result. And so that means if I'm going to take, how about I take every day, I take one attribute of Jesus and I make it part of my life. Because, see, Jesus is not going to be impressed that I was such a, y'all might not think so, but that I was such a great teacher. That ain't going to impress him when I get to heaven. What's going to impress him was, did I have faithfulness to him that made him an expression of Lord over my life? All the stuff that we're doing in the church, and it's necessary that we do in the church because we have earthly things to keep our church going on, but God is looking for you and I to have a heart of faithfulness towards his precepts, towards his oracles, towards his word. Now, you got to understand, the world is never going to accept these principles. The world will make you feel inferior for just following Jesus. They'll laugh at you and scorn you for following the principles of Jesus. But these are the things that God has made us according to purpose to be able to function. So when we start talking about faithfulness, faithfulness is loyalty. It's loyal, it's diligent, it's dependable, it's committed to a purpose, a project, or a person with a relentless resolve of steadfastness. Faithfulness is a faithful, faithfulness is a required spiritual characteristic. You got to have faithfulness, y'all. You got to be able to move. It's got to be a trait that's part of who we are. And this faithfulness is not just in, yeah, we have earthly things that we're getting faithful, our skills in, our things in. But what about your faithfulness to God? Last week, I ended with you, and I want to just say this. I ended in talking about my relationship in terms of really what I want for my children, all of my children, what I want. And I admitted openly that there were some things, yeah, I wanted them to be a rocket scientist. I wanted them to be doctors and lawyers and very successful CEOs and all of the wonderful, prominent titles that they can have in the world. But what will it gain a whole man, or what would it prosper a whole man to gain the whole world and lose his soul? What kind of example would that be as a Christian that I am, that my children don't know the God that I'm following? And I said some things, and some people hit me up and talked to me, and I want to be, let me just say this right now. I don't care if your children is 55 years old. You still can mirror the image that you want and leave a legacy for your children. The Bible says a good man leaves an inheritance for his children's children's children. That legacy is not world system wealth. That's good. That's good. That's good. But that legacy is really talking about a faithfulness, an expression of lordship on your children's children, that they will continue to follow the God that you serve, that they will yell out. That they would yell out like you yell out. They would yell out and say, yes, the God of my father, Femi Iadiji, I call on the same God. That the children would yell out and say, the God of my mother, Wanda Phillips, it is my God. The God of Randall, I call on the God of Randall, my daddy. I call on his God that my grandchildren would call on him. Ladies and gentlemen, I know this is not preaching, and I know it's not popular, and I know it's not saying, you know, you're going to get a Boaz or a car or preach you in a frenzy, but the real idea of this whole thing is about you and I living out the word of God. So faithfulness is a required spiritual character trait. Faithfulness really lends to us what God has called us to do. In fact, I know that faithfulness is a required spiritual character trait. If you do me a favor, you got your Bible, look at 1 Corinthians chapter number 4. 1 Corinthians chapter number 4. Just one verse of scripture. We looked at it last week, but it's worth, I got some teachers in the room. Principal Kelly White and retired but still teaching Ms. Florine White. Y'all know in the classroom, we would go over it again with the children. And I'm not calling nobody, I'm just saying, I'm just teaching. But you go over so we can get this thing, right? So look at 1 Corinthians chapter number 4, right? Redundancy is a tool of learning, right? So 1 Corinthians chapter number 4, look at verse number 2. Just one verse is number 2. I'm reading through the King James, 1 Corinthians. Faithfulness is required of a steward. If you're going to really make Jesus Lord, then you become a steward over his stuff. I was out the last week and I was making mention that even parenting, that the children don't belong to us. How many of you know your children don't belong to you? And so the children belong to God. And God just loved you enough to trust you with his children. And then someone mentioned to me the word parent. The Suffolk part of that word is the word R-E-N-T, rent. That God is, as a steward, you're just renting the children. You do have to take them back. When you rent something, you have to bring it back. And God is going to hold us accountable based on how the parent has worked with the children. Now, that's not for you to feel bad. That's meaning that I don't care if your child is 65 years old, you still have an opportunity to mirror Jesus for them. You have an opportunity to mirror Jesus for them. And you can't taint them with what happened to you in church. This is why my prayer is that you would have a personal relationship with Jesus. We got to remove religion out and get it to the personal relationship with Jesus Christ. That I'm not just teaching about this. We're not, as I tell Nigel, you just can't sing about this. And I know he's working out his stuff, but he's going to keep hearing from his dad, dude. Nope, I know what others are doing, but you're going to have to line up. If you're going to sing it, you're going to have to do your best to live it. Now, I know he's human, just like his dad is human. And I know I can fall and I can have a fall. But I want y'all all to know I'm doing my best to live on the track with Jesus. And hopefully you will pray for me to stay on that track for Jesus. And I'll do the same thing for you as we live on. So look at 1 Corinthians chapter number 4. I'm just about running out of time. First number 2, he says this. Look at this thing, how he shows us right here that faithfulness is a required characteristic and that you got to have this to be a steward. He says, moreover. Oh, y'all got me up here. Moreover, it is required in what? That what? That is in stewards, right? That a man be what? He's got to be faithful. And let me talk about, whatever it is that God has given you, don't forget God gave it to you. Don't forget God gave it to you. Don't forget God gave it to you. Wherever you're working at, God gave that to you. Yes, be faithful to the job. Do what you got to do. But just know God is the one who gave it to you. Be faithful to you because the people on the job ain't always going to be faithful. They're going to always looking how to get over. You be faithful because you know God gave it to you and he's watching how you handle it. You got to understand that faithfulness is a major spiritual character trait in order to move with God. When we look at that scripture and I see steward, let me just to do this. We got to look and understand that definition of steward. And now I didn't get any further, but a steward is one in whose hand is entrusted the business or the property of another. A steward is one in whose hands is entrusted with the business or the property of another. I don't know about you, but that humbles me that God would entrust me in all of my brokenness and frailties and my sins and my faults and my dysfunction and my craziness and all of my stuff that I was in. Because when he called me, I was in that. But he didn't keep me in that. He didn't see me in that. I wish I had some Simons that he can call Peter right now. He didn't see me and he didn't leave me in that state because he saw me that I had the potential to be able to follow and do what he called me to do. And ladies and gentlemen, I'm talking to somebody who is being stubborn, somebody who is still in a stronghold, somebody who still wants to be in control of themselves. And I'm telling you, come out of that stupor that you're in. Come out from where you are. Come out from where you are and take the attributes of Jesus Christ. Help me, Holy Ghost, make this clear. Ladies and gentlemen, I am no match in my flesh for the devil. He is too smart. He is too cunning. He's just too manipulative and too deceptive. But with the Holy Ghost living inside of us, that's why Jesus said, Father, I pray, Father, I'm coming to you now, but I pray that everybody here sitting in Calvary and watching, they got to stay on the earth. They can't leave so that they can carry out and be stewards of the word. But Father, we know that they can't carry out on their own. So we're going to leave the Comforter, the Holy Spirit, going to live inside of them so that they can carry out the diligence, come on, y'all, the faithfulness, the loyalty to me in my word and make me Lord. Because without the Holy Ghost, we just rebels. We just people who go to church who bring our junk from home to the church. We bring our scars and our bruises to church. And then we inflict those scars on other people. And then we repeat it and make mountains out of little small molehills. And God says, you got words to crush that. I've given you authority to speak against that. Why are you making it a mountain? And then you just go about doing good and just go around giving people packs of gum. That's how Deacon Femi does it. He just goes around. And you know, y'all, he's a man, and he has frailties, and he's missed the mark. And I'm sure of that. I don't know nothing about how he missed the mark, but I'm sure he's missed the mark because he's a man. But what I can tell you is his aim is at Jesus. And I don't care how good, if you're a basketball player, I'm always trying to get the ball in the basket, but I don't get it in every time. But my aim is always to get it in. And all I know is that, and when I look at this man who goes around passing out gum, and you see him, but very few people have had the pain that Deacon Femi Adeji has suffered. Very few people have had the pain that this man has suffered. And some of y'all don't know his story, and some of y'all do. But some of you would be shocked to hear the pain that he's had, the pain that he's had, and yet he's still a servant, a steward of Jesus Christ. And you, when you just stub your thumb, stub your toe, now you want to quit the church. Now it's a big problem. I get tired when leaders bring me stupid problems. You know why? Because I'm thinking of Deacon Femi. And he never brings me a problem. He always said, praise the Lord, Pastor. And it isn't praise the Lord, this nonchalant praise the Lord that cool people do. He's internally praising God because he thanks God for allowing him to be a steward. And I bet some of you are going through some pain. And I bet some of you have gone through some stuff. But earth has no sorrow that heaven cannot heal. Because we got a faithful God. I wish somebody knew how faithful he was. Did y'all hear Selena singing this song? I know he will. Well, if you know he will, then I'm not carrying the... Why are you bringing the mess to me if you know Jesus will? Why are you bringing it home to your wife, to your husband, if you know Jesus will? What you should be doing, say, baby, come on, let's touch and agree right now that what your Bible said, that any two or three touching and agreeing on earth, that thing shall be established. Now, I know it's hard sometimes when you're living in a house and you're living in a house with somebody that don't believe. They got intellect, they got smart, they got experience, but they ain't got Jesus, and they haven't made Jesus Lord. So what you got to do then, you got to go to your secret closet. And you got to go in and you got to close the door. And when you close the door, all you got to do is talk to your faithful God, because he's made you a faithful servant. And whatever it is that you need, he says, I'm going to supply it. And no matter what you're going through, I wish I had somebody in here today that will believe that my God is faithful. And if my God is faithful, he's given me the same character traits to be faithful to his word in and out of season, when it's popular, when it's not popular. When people are saying, I wish he choke on his words for preaching truth, but I don't care what they say about me. I'm going to continue to preach truth. I'm going to stand up and do Ephesians 6, 17, 18, 19, and 20. I'm going to preach the gospel with boldness and power. I'm not trying to get you excited. I'm trying to change your life. I'm trying to get you to understand this wonder-working power of the Jesus that we serve. And that faithfulness is the key to what God has called us to do. Ladies and gentlemen, I don't need you to be faithful to me. I don't need you to be faithful. I don't need Lady K to be faithful to me in my marriage. Because if she's faithful to God, then she's going to be faithful to me. I don't need people in the church who got titles and squawns about title, because it ain't about what you do with me. It's about being faithful to God. When you're faithful to God, you don't bring drama. You eliminate drama. When you're faithful to God, you ain't got time to be hearing petty stuff, because you're busy being faithful to the Lord that you're called to serve, knowing that he is the one that you have to answer to. Ladies and gentlemen, you can have anything that God has called for you to have. You can do anything that God has mandated for you to do. His word is true, and all you got to do is believe his word, follow his word. And listen, you got to be diligent. I'm not telling you got to get this right away. You got to be diligent, but if you make up your mind, I'm going to be a follower of Jesus, then you can start today by doing a small thing for a long time until the big result comes. And then you'll find yourself living, and you'll find yourself free from stress, free from anxiety, free from being doubtful, free from talking crazy and negativity. It has no place in the life of the believer. It has no place in the life of the believer. God did not come. He ain't schizophrenic. He don't come with frailty. All his stuff is true. All his stuff is already given the answer to it. So when we sing a song that says, I know he will, that's because he's already done it. Oh, you missed it. When I say he will, that means that he's already done it. He's already given me. He's already exchanged my ashes for beauty. He's already exchanged my pain for joy. He's already given me defeat and given me victory. It ain't that I'm trying to get victory. I got victory already. Is there anybody in here today that got God's victory? Is there anybody in here know that you already got that, that you already win the battle? Is there anybody in here today knowing that you ain't trying to win? You already won. All you got to do is keep your eyes set on him. All you got to do is be like Paul and press towards the mark of the high calling, which is in Christ Jesus. Anybody want to press? Come on, Dr. High, isn't that your book? Pushing towards him. I'm going to keep pushing towards him. I don't care what you say. I'm going to keep pushing my way to Jesus. Come on, stand on your feet. I'm done. I want you to do me a favor, even those who are watching. I want you to over the next course, until God does another shift, I'm going to make Sunday morning, Trustee Doug, a classroom. I'm making Sunday morning a classroom. Bring your notepad, your iPad, take some notes on your phone, download the app, because it is no way we are going to get the application of God's word. And I'm going to have leaders who all know how to function according to God's word. Not what you think. And in fact, we're going to move, because God's word is true. He says, let God's word be true. And what? And every man a liar. His word is true. Stop listening to what man say and start saying what God says. Because if God be for you, who could be against you? If you're here today, and if you're watching today, and you got faithfulness, but it's not in the place of Jesus Christ being Lord. Let me help somebody, because sometimes people in church get it twisted. You're busy doing church work. Church work is not the same as lordship. I don't mean to hurt your feelings. And we do need you to be, we need you to do church work. It's important. It's important. It's important. The time you put in, your volunteer hours, the many volunteer hours you put in, that's important. We're a volunteer organization for the most part. So we need the volunteers. But let me suggest to you, volunteers without making him lordship can get you to the place when you stand before him for him to say, not me, for him to say, depart from me, for I never knew you. Why is that? Because you and I perhaps have never, ever made him Lord. If you're here today, and I don't care how long you've been at Calvary, and I don't care how long you've been watching, I don't care how long you've been confessing, the question is he Lord of your life? Or is prominence Lord of your life? Or position Lord of your life? Or status Lord of your life? Or maybe the pain of your past, you're trying to prove something because of the pain of your past, is Lord of your life. Brothers and sisters, those are all tricks of the enemy. What God is looking for his children that he's created, to be able to declare and decree that he is Lord. And when his people declare that he is Lord, I tell you, there's a shaking that happens in the earth. When we open up our mouth and declare that he's Lord. Is there anybody here today want to declare that Jesus is Lord over your life? I mean, you got so many other things that is Lord over your life. Is today, would you want to shift, turn, and change direction today and say, I'm setting it straight. I'm setting it straight that Jesus is Lord over. See, some of us, we've been in church so long, we forgot about Jesus. Are you here today? You watching today? Somebody want to make Jesus Lord? If you're without a church home today, this is a good church. And for 141 years plus, this church has been in this community, a beacon of light in this community. Not many churches have served a community like this church has served this community. And all I'm saying to you is maybe in the shift in this dispensation, that God is calling us to be now a witness and a discipling church to this community. We've given out, come on, we've given out 2 fish and 5 loaves of bread for 141 years. We serve the community this way. But the B part of that same time that Jesus was with the people, he gave fish and bread, and then he also gave life and word. And maybe the second half of this church will be a church because it served itself well giving out bread and fish, 2 fish and 5 loaves, for years. And here's what the world will do. The world will take your fish, take your bread, and not your Jesus. But you got to learn now and have strategy and wisdom from God to now that we become fisher of men. And that we present Jesus to a dying world. They came and got the COVID shot at Calvary. But will they come and get Jesus at Calvary? That's our job. That's our represent. That we make Jesus Lord. Amen? Are you here today? Somebody want to join Calvary today? If you're here today, if you want to join, you can join even through social media. Just hit us right in the like. Just hit us right in the tagline. Just say, I want to join. And if you want to join, then you get yourself right here. Get yourself here next week and let us know that you did that. And we will welcome you into the fold. And then we will walk with you and teach you the things of Christ. We're not going to move in negativity and craziness. We're not even going to bring up your past, because Jesus don't bring up your past. He does. In fact, he forgets your past. He never brings up your past. Only people bring up your past is you and other people. And if other people bring it up, it don't matter. You just one need to stop bringing up your past and walk in your glorious new future that you have in Christ Jesus. That's how much he's given you faithfulness and trust you over everything. Stop bringing up your past. and walk in your marvelous future. Father, we give you all the praise, honor, and glory today. We thank you for your word that has gone forth and everything that you've done. We give you praise, honor, and glory today because we declare and decree with all of our brokenness, our messed upness, our double-mindedness, our dysfunctionness. But you know what, God? I need one sane second. Give me 10 seconds where I can make a conscious decision right now in the name of Jesus and declare that you are Lord over my life. And that's all you need is one little space to step into my heart and you'll take over my crazy mind, take over my hurtful heart, take over my all of my pain. And Father, when you become Lord, then I get all your attributes. I get your joy. I get your happiness. I get your love. I get all of that. And I'm telling you, if you want it today, he is here for you to have all the pain. All your scars will be thrown away. All your bruises will be gone. All your pain. And walk in the marvelous love. And then you can love your enemies. And you can love people who won't love you back. And you can give mercy when people don't need it. You can give grace to folk who don't even deserve it because God gave you grace. Put your hands together if you need them, Lord, today. Let's get ready for our morning announcement.